Good afternoon, everyone. I think that with the music volume down, it's a signal to us to start. And I have to make a disclaimer here by saying that none of us, and neither New America nor ASAP, planned this event and this talk to take place on Halloween Day. It was just pure coincidence, even though things may look scary in Afghanistan for some people. But we are part of, I'm assuming that we will be discussing Afghanistan in its entirety to the extent possible, and mostly focusing on the way forward. But in my opinion, looking at the way forward means that you have to also look at where you're standing today, and to some extent, look at the way that you have traveled over some time to have reached this place, and what are the different ways that are ahead for Afghanistan. Anyway, my name is Omar Samad. I'm currently a Central Asia Senior Fellow here at New America. I left the Afghan government about 2 years ago. My last posting was as Afghan ambassador to France. I was with the government for 10 years as a diplomat. Since December of 2001, when I went back and became spokesperson for the foreign ministry. But I am very happy today to have a very distinguished panel with us today discussing the issues that each and every one has a lot of not only interest, but a lot of experience in. I know all of them from the past, near and afar, and I've worked with some closely, and I think that they will provide you with a lot of food for thought today. And hopefully, our goal is to have you engaged and hopefully have a discussion on the issues that will be addressed today here. I will ask everyone to obviously turn off their cell phones, if you don't mind. This is an on-the-record discussion. Some people are even taping it, and it's webcast. So for all of those in the on the web world, we welcome you as well. I don't want to spend too much time here with the introductions, as you have seen the you have the short bios of each of our panelists today, but each comes from a specific background and have, as I mentioned, been quite involved in Afghanistan issues, regional issues as well, some in government, some outside of government. So we will give each panelist somewhere around 7-8 minutes, hopefully, to give us their latest thoughts, to share their latest thoughts with us, and we might have a question or two within the panel, and then we will turn to you. This should end hopefully around 1:45. I don't know about the others, but I have to go and get my two little kids to wear something scary, and so I have other duties too. Afghanistan is going through, as you all know, a transition, not a very simple one, not a very easy one, and it's multifaceted, multidimensional, and there is a lot of angst, but there is also an underlying level of, I think, expectation, and maybe even though it's not very palpable, but there's also a certain level of hope that if things turn out right, then Afghanistan is probably saved, and as a result, the investment made over the last 12 years or so would not be in vain, and the sacrifices as well. So the Afghan people, and as an Afghan, speaking as an Afghan, and we're happy to have one other Afghan speaking today as well, who came yesterday from Afghanistan. We are you know, we always say, people say the Afghans are very tough and they're resilient. It's true, we are tough and resilient. I'm not sure how the last 12 years have impacted that resilience, but we are survivalists and we deal with issues and challenges as they come. But we also have learned over the last 35 years, and I'm old enough to remember very well the last 50 years, so over the last 35 years, we have, as you know, undergone several phases of problems and instability and chaos and war and displacement and so on and so forth. And for a country that already was a very poor country, it really has had quite an impact. And this is why the last 12 years, in comparison to most Afghans, looks very unique, very special. And it's not all bad, and it's not all good. It's not black and it's not white. And somewhere in between, for some people, it has been very lucrative and very positive. Their lives have changed positively for the better. And for some, it hasn't changed quite. And they understand what the challenges are. So it's in that context that this country is going through transition. And at the end of the day, it will be very interesting to see how the Afghans themselves cope with this, and then what role will their friends play, and what role will some of the spoilers and those who are not so much inclined to help Afghanistan come out of its issues, what role will they play? And so within Afghanistan, of course, you have the young, and you have the women, and you have the men, and you have the traditionalists, and you have the modern society that has evolved. It's a mixture. It's quite a mixture of different trends that have evolved over the last 12 years. Unfortunately, that reality has not and is not being captured the way we those who deal with these issues on a daily basis would like to capture it. I don't think they are being portrayed as realistically and as accurately as they are. And this is why there is a new thinking in town, at least here, that we need to make sure that the narrative on Afghanistan does not become a negative one or a positive one that is it's in tune with realities of Afghanistan, and that we need to find and portray Afghanistan under a realistic light. And I think that for that purpose, what I would like to do is have one of the co-sponsors of today's talk and someone who represents that new group give a talk to you for 2 or 3 minutes explaining what this new initiative is, to try to make sure that the narrative in Washington and beyond on Afghanistan is the right one. No one is trying to shape it in an unrealistic manner, but it's the right narrative that we deal with. So before we go to the discussion, I would like to ask Scott McKee, who represents the newly formed Alliance in Support of the Afghan People, to introduce himself and to tell us what ASAP, as it's known now, is doing and what it intends to do within 2 minutes, if you can, Scott. Thanks.
2 minutes or less, hopefully. Briefly, though, my name's Scott Mackey, and to begin with, just want to thank New America Foundation for their willingness to host this event with us today. We're very excited to be here. But the Alliance in Support of the Afghan People is a new effort. We just went public last week, and it's a partnership between Afghan civil society leaders and many within the U.S. and the international community who have a shared concern that we together need to highlight, preserve, and protect the gains made in Afghanistan by the Afghan people over the last 12 years. Omar talked about many of the transitions that the country and the people of Afghanistan are facing now into 2014 and beyond. And if we're joined together for one thing, it's to say with mutual voices from Afghanistan and from the United States that it's vital that we get this transition right, that as we've gone through the last 12 years, not always in lockstep, but certainly walking together, that we must continue to stay engaged constructively into the future. The policy points of that are not my own, but we're very excited to be working, and we think that it's a very important endeavor, and are excited to be here today. So thank you, Omar.
Thank you. Thanks, Scott. So with that, now I will turn to my left to David Sidney, who is an American until very recently worked at the Pentagon as Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense, in charge of the Office for Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Central Asia, a very important region. But David and I go back to the early 2000s when he was stationed in Kabul as the number two at the embassy. But he has also served on the National Security Council. So I hope that David will give us his views on what he thinks the security framework looks like, how as we move forward, and especially there is so much talk and so much interest on the BSA, the bilateral security agreement between the U.S. and Afghanistan, that's in sort of holding mode and not signed yet, but being reviewed as we move forward in relations between Afghanistan and the United States. David, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Omar. I'm going to take 1 second beforehand to follow up on Scott's announcement about the alliance in support of the Afghan people. And for those in the room here, I've tried to pull up, and it's hard to see the website, AfghanAlliance.org. I urge people to, if you're in the audience now, to go ahead and dial it up, take a look at it. It's, I think, important because of both the visuals that it presents, the wide range of people who have signed on to support it, and the information that's available through it. That is why I am a part of this organization, and because my experience over the last, really, 30-plus years of my service in the State and Defense Departments, but particularly on the issue of Afghanistan, I've seen that if a story is 100% negative, then the media is 100% negative. If a story is 50% negative and 50% positive, then the media is 100% negative. If the story is 90% positive and 10% negative, the media is 90% negative and 10% positive. In other words, there's a huge negative bias in the way our media reports, and that means there's a huge negative bias in the information that the American people have, that the members of Congress and their staffs have, when they're making decisions. And in the case of Afghanistan, that bias has become dysfunctional. Our major media outlets, and I've spoken to them directly on this, present such a warped view of Afghanistan that it's not possible for our political leaders currently to make an intelligent, informed decision. Since I left the government, I've been speaking to a number of groups from all over the United States, and I find repeatedly that people have a very, very inaccurate view of what's happening in Afghanistan. So you can get the negative view in Afghanistan from the Washington Post, New York Times, et cetera, et cetera. But what you'll get from us is a balanced view. What you'll get from me in particular is a balanced view that's very balanced on the positive side. And why is that? Well, I spent the last 4 years of my life at the Department of Defense, as the ambassador was saying, working on helping. The number one job there was to help to build the Afghan security forces. Well, we have just finished what is euphemistically called a fighting season in Afghanistan. In other words, a period of time when the Taliban and their allies launch attacks from across, primarily from across the border in Pakistan into Afghanistan, and try and take over the country of Afghanistan, overthrow the leadership, and put the Taliban back into place. As they have in the previous 11 years, they failed. But this time they failed because the Afghan security forces not only took the lead, but were entirely unilaterally responsible for security for their own country in well over 95% of the operations in Afghanistan. If the Afghan army, the Afghan police, and the Afghan intelligence service had failed to perform this summer, then Afghanistan might have fallen to the Taliban. But in fact, they did not. And this was contrary to the estimates of many in the U.S. government, outside the U.S. government, in other countries. Many believed when this transition to Afghan leadership took place, a transition that most Americans don't even realize took place, but actually did take place this year, many believed that when that transition took place, that Afghanistan would become much more chaotic, much more lawless, that the Afghans would seize large swaths of territory, would seize district centers, would seize some provinces, Not only did none of that happen, but the Afghan security forces not only held all the gains that had been made in the previous 10 years by international forces and Afghan forces working together, but they made progress, including into some areas where international forces and U.S. forces had pulled out of in the prior 3, 4, or 5 years. So the Afghan army went back into some of the toughest areas in the Konar Nuristan area and took back areas that we had unilaterally ceded to the Taliban 3 or 4 years before. This is a story that I think very few people in the United States are aware of. They're aware of problems with casualties in the Afghan services because that's reported. And yes, the Afghan military, the Afghan police, the Afghan intelligence services have suffered much greater casualties as they've taken the lead. At the same time, of course, casualties suffered by foreign forces, U.S. casualties, casualties from our neighboring, from our partners in NATO and the non-NATO partners in Operation Enduring Freedom, our casualties have gone down dramatically over the last 2 years as the Afghans have picked up that burden. My own experience in dealing with the Afghan security forces, with people at the leadership level, ministerial, generals, colonels, and down to people serving as privates, while they are very concerned by the level of casualties, every individual death, every person who's wounded, every person who is incapacitated is an individual tragedy. Afghans, by and large, in fact, I would say in the military and security services, very large, are proud that they are now fighting for themselves and that we aren't fighting for them. It's been the goal of those who have been building the Afghan army for the last 10 years for that to happen, for Afghans to be responsible for Afghan security, and that's what's happened now. Now, that's happened because of great sacrifice and great contributions in many ways by the people of the United States, the military of the United States, the people of our NATO and other allies, and the taxpayers, because the Afghan security services still require a large amount of funding, billions of dollars of a year support from outside of Afghanistan, and will continue for a number of years. But this is an untold success story. If we were sitting up here today and talking about all the gains the Taliban had made, I would admit it. I would say there'd been a failure. But there's actually been a great success here. But that success is fragile. The Afghan security forces next year will face, as Mullah Omar said when Secretary Kerry was in Kabul and signed made the agreement with President Karzai to move forward in the bilateral security agreement, Mullah Omar came out with a statement saying, "Watch out, Afghanistan. We're going to start fighting even more. We're going to send more people in to try and kill more people in Afghanistan and try and destroy the Afghan security forces." That's going to happen. The Taliban does have resources. As I said, their leadership, training, and financing are primarily in areas in Pakistan that it's not possible to go after because of geopolitical realities. So that threat is going to continue. Violence, unfortunately, is going to continue in Afghanistan until the Taliban realize that they have that their effort is futile. But the performance of the Afghan security forces, I will predict with a great deal of confidence based upon the reality of the past 12 months, the Afghan security forces will get even better. Now, again, that doesn't mean they don't have problems. There are serious problems, and I'm happy to address questions about those. But to me, the important thing for the American people to realize is that that has been a success. Now, as I said, that success depends upon continuing support. And that is where one reason, where I have great concern. U.S. policy towards Afghanistan, I believe, in the recent years has been somewhat of a drift. The support from the American people has gone down, the support in the Congress has gone down, and we have mixed signals from the leadership of our, mixed signals from our leadership in the United States on how long and how serious our commitment to Afghanistan will be, particularly in the military and security side. We have succeeded in so much. We have the opportunity to have Afghanistan, which has been the subject of contention for centuries and been in the midst of a series of violent conflicts for the last 35 years. We have a chance for that all to change. But we can also lose that if we don't have that, if we don't have a continued commitment. And that commitment needs to be financial, it needs to be political, but it also needs to come from the from a clear understanding of what the stakes are involved and what the commitment will cost, but also what the benefits will be, not just for the people of Afghanistan and the region around there, but for the United States. And the sad reality is, on the security side, is that Al-Qaeda remains a threat. Al-Qaeda in the Afghanistan-Pakistan region continues to be active at levels that, if military pressure is not sustained, will become as great a threat to us as they were 10 to 15 years ago. So we have a national security interest. But I would say beyond that, we have a moral, ethic, and value-based reason to stay in Afghanistan. We've supported the growth of a military that is unlike any military that Afghanistan has had before, one that's responsive to the will of the people. We have equipped that military very well. If we don't continue to support Afghanistan politically, we will have introduced a military force into a region without the kinds of controls that are necessary for it to behave responsibly. There are many, many bad paths that can result, and the best insurance against those bad paths is a continued U.S. commitment on the Afghan security front. I think I've taken my 7 minutes. As Omar knows, I could go on forever, but I will cut myself off here.
Thank you, David. Thank you very much. Well, as we mentioned earlier, security is one of the important items of transition in Afghanistan and for the international community as well. And there are others. And social mobility in Afghanistan, the role of women and youth is another. And we have seen tremendous progress. I mean, I'm a critic of the government. This is why I'm no longer in government. I can afford to be critical. But I do admit that the Afghanistan, the society that we have today, the mobility, the access to information, media, youth movements, the women working, studying, is nothing compared to what we inherited in 2001. And the challenge is how to protect these gains and at the same time make sure that there is no backtracking and that it advances. So I will turn to Eleanor Smeal. I had the privilege of getting to know Eleanor in 1998 when I, accompanied by three other Afghans, two ladies and one gentleman, went to her office and asked them if the feminist majority knew it was doing anything about Afghan women. And I have to say that ever since then, Eleanor has been a champion of the Afghan women's cause, besides the fact that she is a champion and a very well-known leader of women's rights in the United States and across the globe. So it's an honor to have you here, Eleanor, and thank you for everything that you and your organization have done so far. But the question is, where do you think we stand today? Do the Afghan women stand today? And how would you like to see the process move forward for them?
Thank you very much. We are supporting this effort for many of the same reasons that David just said, is that we think that the picture that's being painted is only the negative, and that there is much positive. But let me just go back a little bit about why would the feminist majority, which is principally a domestic group, have gotten involved. We got involved actually even earlier than that meeting. We got involved in the late 1996 after the Taliban took over Kabul. And I always try to remind people of where we were then and where, how bad the situation was. When we noticed, and it was very small articles, that women couldn't be employed, couldn't go to school, I could go on the list. I don't even think people realize that by the firing of all women nurses, for example, and doctors, and my understanding, we were a good percentage of the doctors and nurses, we helped to collapse, they collapsed the healthcare system of Afghanistan, which at various times in its history was quite advanced for Central Asia. And basically, I don't know which particular thing just said we got to do something, but not even infant girls could be seen at hospitals, let alone adults. It was a horrific separation of the sexes. In fact, we began to call it gender apartheid, in which women could not really our girls have any education, employment, et cetera. And we began to study the situation, which we found horrific, and were very upset by the fact that although there had been a fourth United Nations conference in 1995 in Beijing, in which our own First Lady, at that time Hillary Clinton, had declared women's rights are human rights and human rights are women's rights, here all basic human rights were being taken away from all females. And nobody was saying anything. And we tried to get other groups going, but everybody didn't have room to put this on their plate first. We decided that if this became recognized, it would be horrific for the women of Afghanistan and the women of the world. In essence, our rights would count for nothing, human rights. And basically, what really horrified us is that we learned that United States and the United Nations was going to recognize the Taliban government. And we didn't know what to do, but we knew we had to do something. And I won't go through everything, but I'm very proud of the fact that we led an anti-stop gender apartheid campaign, which hundreds of thousands of Americans became involved in, all kinds of celebrities. We had over 100 major celebrities. And I know that our campaign helped to make it so that in March 11th, 1998, the President Clinton, Reno, then who was Attorney General, Madeleine Albright, Secretary of State, and Kofi Annan, who was then Secretary General of the United Nations, had a press conference. And I think the date was very important because they were celebrating International Women's Day, which is March 8th. And they announced that they would not recognize the Taliban. And I do believe that part of it, a major part of it, was the treatment of women and the campaign that was now international. We were working with the European Parliament, women's groups all over the world. Well, then it only got harder, and things kept going down. And the reason I'm going through this, and I'm looking at my clock because I got to do it very fast, is that we have to understand where we were when the Taliban fell. I mean, you know, the Afghan people were facing starvation. We, as a movement, were begging the World Food Program to get in there and get more food. There had been a major drought. Things were horrific in every way. From then to today, and that's why I say as compared to what, there's been major advances. Are they what they should be, or is everything per? I wanted a Marshall Plan for Afghanistan. We had been calling for even much more greater civic development than there has been. But let's go to where we are today. Right now, women, girls are about, and no numbers are perfect. We're going to put on our website, we're doing a whole revamping the website. It'll be up in a couple weeks, of numbers that we think we can trust. But, you know, let's face it, there really hasn't been a census. It is very difficult to get numbers. But we think that somewhere between 35% and 40% of the elementary school-age children that are going to school are now women, or girls, I mean, and that we're a lesser percentage of the high school, but certainly there. Now, for neither boys nor girls is life perfect. We only have about 60% of the eligible, of the age group of boys in elementary school, and about 40% of the girls, in other words, of all students. So there's a way to go. But in fact, it's an improvement for both boys and girls. I mean, because remember, during the Taliban, only about a million, I think it was only about a million kids were in school. They were all boys. Today, it's something like 7 million in primary school. Obviously, a lot less in secondary school, but they exist. One of the surprising things I tell people is, do you realize how many colleges or institutions of higher learning we now have operating? Not we, but the Afghan people have operating? And they don't even realize they have colleges operating, but it's 57 institutes of higher learning. That is a big leap. Of that, of course, women are not half the students, but we're at least 25% of the students, or somewhere thereabouts. We're certainly now about 22%, or that's what the government says, of the civilian workforce in the government. You know, but again, the numbers that might be not be perfect, but there we are now in the employment workforce. And so it, in every measure, we're better off. I think that a hopeful thing occurred this summer. We have been begging and begging for more funding of women's organizations, indigenous women's organizations in Afghanistan. And I am very happy to say that we have won earmarks in these last years. But the biggest breakthrough was this summer when USAID announced a $416 million civil society for women program. That's huge, over 5 years. Of which the United States was going to pledge over $200 million immediately. This was, and it was not only to help on the civil society, but to help build women's organizations. Right now, we estimate, well, let's say it this way, the Afghan Women's Ministry, they have 248 women's organizations that are being built, that are there already. But forget numbers. We are also very in touch with the heartbeat. Women's groups are all over the country. There is a women's movement that is blossoming. We sponsor some 30 Afghan women going to college here in the United States a year. Our kids that go back, the reports they give me are so enthusiastic. They have no reason to exaggerate either. They're going back to their home province. They see, I'll never forget this one kid that had gone to back to Bamiyan, and she said, Ellie, the midwives are really being trained. I've gone into small little provinces, and they have medical facilities. They never had this before. And what's the result of having trained more midwives? Again, the numbers are not sure, but somewhere near 4,000. The maternal mortality rate has gone down appreciably. It's been cut into, and it's one-fourth of what it was. So there's real gains in healthcare, there's gains in education, and there's gains in employment. Now, could you flip it and say the bad things? Of course. But you got to look at, what's going on. Also, we're very worried about violence towards women. They're still reporting something like 85% of women suffer violence. We want more protection, et cetera, and certainly more security. But I would say there has been, in some areas, significant gains. We have a lot to fight for. I think this is no time to desert the Afghan people. I think, in fact, we should be providing more on the civil society and building the civil society. And we're right there. We certainly aren't going anywhere. I believe that women's groups throughout the world would want to help the Afghan women if they only knew how to. Thank you.
Thank you, Eleanor. Thank you so much. The other dimension, obviously, of this period of transition has to do with issues very much on people's mind in Afghanistan, issues such as governance, state building, and institution building. And so the economy also sort of is connected to all of this, and people are very worried about what might happen when money dries up or shrinks to a level where it's much less than what they have been accustomed to over the last 12 years or so. And Afghanistan, in the views of some Afghans, is not yet on its own feet, and its domestic revenue levels are still low, and the insurgency obviously has had an impact on economic growth and development and investment. So to address all of those issues within 7 minutes, we have Claire Lockhart. And Claire, to me, is a half Afghan. She has caught the Afghan bug. I first met Claire in Kabul when she was an advisor to the Minister of Finance. And ever since then, she has been an advocate and has focused on state effectiveness. And she's the director of the Institute for State Effectiveness. And we're happy to have her here today. Claire, please.
Thank you. And like the other speakers, I really welcome both this panel and the formation of ASAP. Like the others, I see, and I assume many of you, we've seen after the fall of the Taliban in 2001, a period of years when the press was actually quite relentlessly positive. And some of us actually came to meet some editors and say, you've got to start reporting on the negative as well, otherwise we won't be able to get the change we need. And they were very skeptical, and they said, no, everything's perfect. And then, it never rains, then it pours, and then we've had 5 years of relentless negativity. And striking that balance is terribly, terribly important, both to get the story accurate, but also, as Mr. Sedney pointed out, to inform those decision makers so they can make the right decisions. One of my colleagues and friends is a civil society activist who's just completed a book called Let Me Breathe, and he argues that the last decade has actually been a chance for many citizens literally to breathe and to find a new life. And he's tried to paint that story, and I'm thrilled that others are going to be trying to do so. I'll put my own bias on the table. I spent several years in Afghanistan working with the UN and the Afghan government, and I was part of, with them, the efforts to build institutions. But this meant I was a witness to it, and when I read the negative stories in the media, I don't recognize the country that they're describing. What I saw was something fundamentally different. So contrary to this picture of failure, there's been incredibly impressive successes with institution building led by Afghans. At the beginning in 2001 to 2, many outsiders spoke of either a blank slate or a lawless land. The reality was very different. There was an administrative and legal structure that had actually withstood 2 decades of war and conflict, a structure that was quite robust, 240,000 civil servants in place around the country carrying out their functions. Reviews by the IMF and the World Bank in 2001 showed that Afghanistan actually had some of the best laws in the world, the budget law and so on. And since then, building on this basis, there have been some extraordinary successes. The Afghan National Army that Mr. Sedney has described, the health program, the National Solidarity Program. You know, there have been elections in now over 30,000 villages, and 100,000 women have had leadership positions on the village councils across the country. The formation of the one-stop shop for business registration, ISA, the telecoms, and so on. We know, I mean, these stories are now quite familiar to us, but they're real, and many of them are large scale, and many of them are hailed within the development world as some of the best successes in South Asia or even in the world. An extraordinary statistic is Afghanistan, since 2001, is actually the country that has grown furthest and fastest up the Human Development Index of any country in the world. So these successes are real, and for those of us who've had the privilege to spend time in Afghanistan and see it, they are real. Now, of course, there are also some significant challenges. Some of the corruption that has set in is also real, and particularly, you know, this came to a head with the Kabul Bank and the failure of the central bank. The police have had particular challenges, and there is something of a centralized administrative structure that perhaps doesn't provide the citizens with the right accountability mechanisms. But contrary to popular perception, this isn't written into the Constitution. By contrast, the Constitution mandates, for example, elections of mayors in towns and cities. It's just that they haven't happened. So there has been an over-centralization. The subnational governance law that was meant to allocate functions to different levels was written in a very centralized way, and some of those changes, I think, for the next generation of Afghans to debate and change. But it's something that struck me is there was recently a delegation of civil society representatives and village leaders from Pakistan came to Afghanistan. And at the end of the trip, they said, you know, we're really angry with our leaders in Pakistan because they've told us for years that Afghanistan was this backward, lawless country that couldn't govern itself, which is why Pakistan has to govern it for them. But what we've seen is, in many respects, Afghanistan's institutions are better functioning and more advanced than ours, and we're going to go back with that message to Pakistan. Some reflections on institution building. I think, you know, where's it gone wrong in the last years? One is that it needn't cost money. It's really a question. Those initiatives that worked were a question of getting the design right. And the ones that worked, for the most part, didn't cost the billions of dollars that we've read about. And those initiatives that did cost the billions of dollars didn't work. And I think there's a real imperative now to try and learn the lessons about which institutions and programs do need preserving, because they're providing real value to citizens and are worth a commitment, and which ones have been more wasteful and need to be cut back. But the biggest tragedy would be cutting off the funds altogether and seeing the tremendous gains dwindle, because there will be a need for continued financial commitment. So the burden really is getting the design of engagement right in the post-14 era. Second, institutions are composed of people and are deeply informed by politics. And we all know that coming up next spring is the next Afghan election. So getting that election right, who will lead, what political mandate, what team of leaders will be leading those institutions is going to be fundamentally important to the future of Afghanistan. And then what the US and other external supporters can do is really to support the fairness, the openness, and the credibility of those elections. And institutions are composed of the people who will be staffing them. And here, the tremendous successes of a next generation coming of age, we'll hear from the 1400 group as one of the tremendous successes amongst that. This is what gives, I think, a lot of us incredible hope for the future. Finally, complementary to governmental institution building, the institutions of the economy and the market and of civil society are as, if not more, important. And investing in an Afghan economy that can generate its own revenue, can provide jobs for the next generation, and foster a legitimate economy is also going to be very, very important. And here, there's a good news story. The 80% of the people in the country who work in the agricultural economy and the supply chains have grown, but it provides 20% of the GDP. Continued support to building those value chains in agriculture will be fundamental to Afghanistan's self-sustainability. The industry and light industry, the construction, and the story of mining. It's not the magic bullet, for sure, that some have said, but getting this sector right is going to be of a real key to Afghanistan's future. The estimates of $1 to $3 trillion worth of oil, gas, and minerals are probably, in my view, an underestimate. And so getting the governance of that right to unlock Afghanistan's future financial sustainability so that Afghanistan doesn't need to keep coming back to the US and other taxpayers to support its institutions will be the key to keeping the lights on. Afghanistan and its region, which what some people have called the new Silk Route, the Chinese say the old trunk road, but really the picture of Asian economic integration is another part of Afghanistan's future sustainability. In closing, I think one of the most important measures to continue to support will be the education system. And not training thousands of people in PhDs for the sake of it, but certainly going beyond primary education so that Afghanistan itself can have the officials, the technicians, the entrepreneurs to sustain itself. So again, that they don't need to rely on the largesse or technical assistance from abroad. And finally, that we should move away from having an either-or picture of security or development. I think as anyone who lives in the country, it's the institution building and the economic development is going to rest on continued commitment to security to see the gains sustained. And 2014, such a key opportunity to learn from mistakes and get the engagement going forward right. Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. You did very well covering a lot of issues that are critical. And since you did mention the new generations, we are very happy to have, straight from Kabul, a member of the new Afghan generation that is extremely dynamic, I would say, and a generation that is very thoughtful. And for once, I see critical thinking amongst the youth in Afghanistan and those who have been exposed to education and exposed to globalization after years of living in darkness. So having Haseeb Homayoun here with us is an honor, and he is a member of Afghanistan 1400, a civil and political organization that wants to enable and create a platform, political platform for Afghan youth and the new generation for the future. They have a role to play today. So, Mr. Homayoun, tell us what role do you see for Afghan youth, and especially in the context of political transition, especially with elections coming up, and to some extent, their views maybe also on
the reconciliation process and how to end war, if you don't. So you have 7 minutes to cover that, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. Thank you for that kind introduction. It's great to be back in Washington. And one of the upsides of being on such a distinguished panel is that a lot of the big issues get covered. So I'll be very pointed straight. I'll talk about largely what what's being called the new generation, but as a whole, the whole transformation of the country in the past 10 to 12 years. I think one thing that gets underestimated by people outside the country and even internally inside of Afghanistan, what has happened is the sort of the gradual transformation of the country in many ways is ahistoric. Claire gave an idea of in terms of numbers, in terms of institutions that have been developed, but largely what we're noticing is the transformation of our social fabric. New ideas, new lexicons, if you will, are being internalized, things such as democracy, human rights, women rights, or the role for youth of the country more, being more prominent. These are largely in a society that used to be pre-2001 governed by rather traditionalist systems. They're new. They're new, but they're being internalized. In particular to that, what I will focus, and I'm it's very difficult for me coming from Kabul today to avoid that, is the whole, in some ways, election mania. That's what's going on in the country, be it in Kabul, around the outside Kabul, elsewhere. The crucial factor in it is that democracy, the constitutional order in general, is increasingly being internalized. The presidential elections are often very much talked about in international media, and people have a lot of assumptions or predictions attached to it, but what's being missed from the equation is the provincial council elections. On the ground in the country, there's a very, in many ways, what I would call a prospering and in some ways a promising marriage of the presidential election politics with local provincial council elections for the future of democracy in the country. Previously, what you used to have were the two elections we've had experience with presidential and provincial council was there was a disconnect between people who were setting themselves up for provincial council seats and those who were running from the center on tickets for presidential. In 2013, what we're noticing increasingly is there's synergy between these two camps. That younger, more ambitious folks on the ground in far-off provinces or districts who want to get legitimacy, political legitimacy through getting public votes are coming to the center, allying themselves with a particular ticket, but also the center, people in the center who are interested in the political future of the country or who are running on tickets, reaching out to folks on the ground who are identifying them either as potential provincial council candidates or who already exhibit ambition and allying them. So there is essentially, what I'm trying to suggest here is that democratic processes, the right, people's right to vote, as well as people turning to the vote of the public for legitimacy, this is being weaved. This fabric is new, and this is now increasingly becoming a lot more internalized. One of the indicators of this internalization of democracy or of our elections, and this in some ways take it as a joke, take it as a reality of it, is in 2004 and 2009, a lot of people in the media or in the public sphere were speculating about who's America's candidate. The question was, who will the United States back? So then the perception then followed from there that that person will eventually win. Today, very frankly, nobody's asking that question. No one in the country is asking who's the United States candidate in the race. But one question people are asking absolutely is who's Ahmed Karzai's candidate. Now that change, that shift, it has its upsides and its downsides. The way Ahmed Karzai, the president, has played this, he's been very very sharp in not making it look like he has any favorites in the race. So everybody's out there guessing who his favorite is, but to us, as people who are active in the political space, what it indicates largely is that people are now turning to democratic contest, to this process. One crucial lesson, again, one other indicator of where we are as a generation and what's out there for us in the future is we tend to think, and maybe there's a level of hopefulness in this attack, that certain characters of the past 30 to 40 years of our mayhem in the country, this election in some ways is the peak for them. That they are testing both their options as well as testing their popularity. Some of them may wake up to a very unhappy picture in April 6, 2014, where they're embossed image of the past 10, 12 years may not prove to be real what in the ballot boxes. Some of them may end up getting more votes than they expected. But in many ways, what that to us means is that there are people now accepting the constitutional order and the democratic contest that it has set up as the only game in town. And this has been gradual. This has been gradual. I've talked about this in the past, that in the 2010 parliamentary elections, if you contrast the people who ran for office in the 2010 parliamentary elections with people who ran for office in 2005, you'll see that in 2010, you have a higher pool of more powerful local actors running for office. In 2005, they had opted to stay out of democratic contest. They had thought that the power they had, or the guns and guys and all they had around them, was good enough. They did not need to become part of a system that was constitutional. For 5 years afterwards, I think what they realized was that both prominence, prestige, as well as even access to business, access to even immunity and protection, comes from being part of the system that's built through the 2004 Constitution. So they have started playing game. They have started to even somewhat, at least nominally, disarm and nominate themselves for offices. That trend is largely continuing. For us, for the new generation ambassador, if I could tie it to this question of peace with Taliban, or the question of largely what do you do with people who are outside the system and throwing stones at it, is I think I represent the sentiment of the new generation that there is a negotiated settlement between the people of the country. And that negotiated settlement is the 2004 Constitution. That Constitution represents the will of the people. It has a fairly wide array, a space for people to operate in it, be it whichever group. And in some ways, I think we're getting that sense, the indicators of it, that even people who until a year or two ago were fighting that order with bullets or with IEDs and bombs are now coming around to it. So among the 10 people that are the 10 candidates who were vetted by a preliminary process, they're now into the Election Complaints Commission's process. One guy, I think it doesn't get international media attention, Qutbuddin Hilal, used to be the deputy of Gulbuddin Hikmatyar at least until 6-7 months ago. And he's married to Gulbuddin's daughter. So very much representing one faction of the armed opposition or the insurgency to the central government in Kabul. What has flickered this change in Hikmatyar and Qutbuddin Hilal's calculation, I think, is largely it's a growing confidence in this constitutional order, that this is to remain, this will stay here, and this will in many ways shape the country's future. Now, that's the optimism. To us, largely, there are tests associated to this optimism. I think the presidential election is in many ways the biggest test of this constitutional order. We have to get it right. There, for a long time, there was both internal and external pessimism about whether we would even go into an election season. Whether President Karzai has the political will to conduct elections or not, do we have the administrative capabilities for holding elections, given the insecurity and all the other challenges associated. But increasingly, we're getting signs that, at least on the administrative side and on the side of President Karzai's political will, there are positive news to be heard. The electoral calendar that was announced by the previous election commission is being adhered to with minor 1 to 2 or 3 days of changes back and forth, but that's always understandable, knowing that, again, we're in many ways an infant democracy, if you will. And what we will need to be watching closely is how the political contest, and I could close on this, is how the political contest unfolds, the way the tickets have shaped. They're largely aligned in adherence to the Constitution, but there are also, in many ways, people are testing new ideas. New ideas, new compositions, new formations of who's on the ticket and who's not. We have about 2 months of campaign period that begins in late January and February and goes on all the way to April. How people position themselves, what kind of a narrative that comes out of that, whether people get mobilized to come around and vote, I think remains to be seen. What I can report is that in many ways compared to 2005 and 2009 in particular, there's much greater interest today. Far greater interest and participation in the elections, in part perhaps because in 2009 at least we had the incumbency factor. There was the perception that President Karzai is the incumbent with access to state machinery and a lot of prominence, name recognition, and that he need not be campaigning a lot, mobilizing people. This time around, we have about 10 people, at least as of yesterday, on the ballot, many of them with prominent, none with a grand national appeal, but many of them with sort of segmented constituencies that they will mobilize on their own. And as a whole, it adds up to much bigger mobilization than previous elections in the country. For, again, the elections, the political transfer of power, this test of the Constitution that's coming up, largely will dictate the path, the future for our generation and for what's going to happen to the country. The biggest, at least the one agenda item that's prominent for our generation, for groups like 1400 and others, is that we move away from personality-based politics to more organized politics. That this election and this practice of democracy not turn certain what's being called in the international press and elsewhere as vote banks, or some kingmakers and others, not turn them into much bigger one person, less reliable, less predictable figures in the political space than they are today. So how, and that will again, that achieving that result will largely depend on how we behave within the next 6 to 7 months. Another encouraging factor related to elections is, and this in particular to provincial council as well as presidential, is that we have about 320 women running for office around the country for provincial council. That's despite, in some places, the challenge of insecurity, the challenge of even resources, access to resources for women compared to male candidates. For the first time also in the history of the country, on a mainstream ticket, there's a VP, there's a woman as a VP on a ticket that's being perceived as one, at least one of the top five, in largely. So in some ways, these are indicators that the country is moving forward. Granted, again, we get the elections test right, and we also have some results where we close the discussions around BSA, the bilateral security agreement with the United States. That agreement largely is the market stability, money staying in the country, as well as people investing, is very much tied to this question of what happens to the BSA. I think as of last week, the perception in the country, the general sentiment around it, is that it's in its last stages. That Secretary Kerry's visit, the discussions with President Karzai, and then the following press conference, all of it, have in many ways narrowed down the differences going into to the November 19th to 21st Loya Jirga. I think the outstanding questions are much fewer than they could have been in the past. What I can report to you from on the ground is the larger question that remains for the people, and there's clarity emerging around it, is this question of whether the United States is asking for impunity or is it asking for jurisdiction. The perception was, and this was largely at fault of our own political actors, our own public space, even analysts and others, they were playing with the word immunity too much. That a BSA with the United States means that the U.S. troops will have immunity on the ground, and no matter if they commit a crime, they will not be charged either here or elsewhere. But as of last week, there is a greater effort to try to define that what is being quoted in that document and what is being asked for or being granted is not immunity, but it's jurisdiction, that even if a crime is committed, it will be prosecuted under laws in the U.S. by the United States, and that's what the U.S. is asking. So I think going into the Jirga, the outstanding question will be this question of immunity versus jurisdiction and whether people will vote for it or not remains to be seen. But broadly, the sentiment again, the fundamentals into the election and the future of the country are one, stability, a continuation of the order that we've established in the past 12 years, letting it mature and test itself, and the other is gradual reforms within our own system. And I'll close at that, Ambassador. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Homoyun. Very insightful and useful information and views. Since we have about half an hour left, I think we'll take advantage of this time to open up to the floor here, and please do introduce yourselves and ask the question as briefly as you can, and we will start over there, please. There is a mic going around. Yeah.
Hi, Doug Brooks with the Afghan-American Chamber of Commerce. I get asked a lot about the warlord culture and where that's going, and is that going to be something that's going to surface again in the future, and should we not have done something about this 10 years ago? So I just wonder if I can put that to the panel and then see their thoughts on that.
Okay, let's take a couple of more questions, and then we'll let me go to the back, the lady over right in the middle, sorry. Can you raise your hand again? She's here. Right. No, not in the back, sorry, in the middle.
Hi, Mehreen Farouk from WRD, the World Organization for Resource Development Education. WRD actually just recently did a study across about 15 provinces in Afghanistan looking at these kinds of peace-building initiatives that are being carried out by civil society organizations, tribal elders, and religious networks across the country. So I really must say I do applaud the efforts of ASAP, because I think the future of Afghanistan lies within the hands of the Afghan people, and it's important to share the positive stories of what's been accomplished over the past 13 years so that we can continue the investments in this region. So my question is, how do you recommend to the international community, those who are interested in partnering with civil society, how do we engage Afghanistan's civil society when reports are indicating that after the international community's troop withdrawal, that the security situation will make things increasingly difficult for us to carry out these types of partnerships?
Thank you. And one more here, and then we'll go back. We'll come back to you, right here.
Thank you. William Bree from DynCorp International. First, it's nice to hear the glass half full story. You're right, we don't hear it very often here. I'm an optimist. I think that Karzai and Obama will reach agreement on the immunity question, and there will be a BSA, and there will be a small international troop presence, and the international community will continue to provide aid. But Obama, in his State of the Union speech, said the U.S. role after 2014 is going to be training, equipping the ANSF, and doing some counterterrorism. But I see that CSTICA is currently just dismantling the training for the ANS as fast as they can. And I'm beginning to think that the training, which I expected we would be providing to help the ANS continue to mature, is really going to be tiny after 2014. I can see this going two ways. The ANSF, you know, figures out how to do this themselves. They build up the things that they're weak on now, and they'll go in the right direction. I could also see it sort of being a downward spiral. I just wondered, with the glass half full, you know, which way you think that would go. And I think it ties into the last question about support for assistance organizations.
Thank you. Let me throw the first question to Mr. Homoyun about the warlord culture, subculture, past culture, future culture.
Sure. I tend to avoid that word. I have to be honest with you. Commanders, if you will, are people who come from a time where we had more armed conflict in the country. Now, what's happening to that culture? Several things. I think one of them, and I have to report to you, is that the generational shift. Many of them, over the past 2-3 decades, they amassed resources, they amassed a lot of both financial as well as political clout. They used it to educate their own kids. So what you call with that the commander class, in many ways, they now have sons and daughters who are graduates of NYU or JNU in India or Sorbonne in France and elsewhere. They're coming back with much different lenses about what ought to happen in the country or in the world, and how the country needs to be positioned, or even questioning the legacies of their own parents, some of them. That's a fact. That's a trend that's developing. In certain other ways, a few other of these characters are positioning their offsprings for taking over and being more and more essentially aligned with their way of thinking. The question remains again: what will happen once they are less important, and that generational shift happens? Elections again becomes a key indicator in this. One of the questions for us in 1400, for our generation largely, is: how do people vote or how do we mobilize in 2013 and on 2014 in the elections, that the way people vote does not turn people who are more leftovers of a different kind of politics and conflict in the country into bigger actors after 2014 than they are today. Now, that risk is obviously there, because one of the things we kept insisting as a group in 1400, but largely the younger generation in the country, two political actors who are involved in government and outside, was to start mobilizing, start reaching out to the people, as opposed to make meetings in the back door and try to create what was at that time being perceived as a national consensus or a big ticket where everybody saw themselves. That was A, unlikely to happen. B, what it did was it strengthened the hands of people who had inherited power from the years of the conflict. So going into elections, a lot of tickets in many ways have had to take them into account. They are a reality in the country that, again, will gradually transform with their own generational shifts and our own generational shifts in the country and how people vote in 2014, and remains to be seen. I think one of the key indicators to watch in 2014 is what happens to this question of vote bank and personalities dictating much bigger space in politics than organizations would.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. Claire and Eleanor, both of you or either of you, would you like to address this issue of security and civil society activism?
Well, security is a major issue for women. There's no question about that, and violence. And my opinion is that for Afghan society and this whole future development, it depends largely on women. I don't think we should be viewed as the marginal class, or it would be nice if women have rights. I think we have to have a bigger, and I was sort of going to the second question, a bigger part of the peace building process. And obviously, there's no single group more opposed to the commander culture than women. They were left out of that culture, and they want to play. I think that it's very encouraging that women are now getting law degrees, medical degrees. There are some women judges. They've been very courageous in the drug courts. And basically, young women want a modern life. But I also think their mothers want the young woman to have a modern life, too. And I think many fathers. And I hear it over and over again from the young people that we are in touch with. And so I'm very hopeful that that culture is a thing of the past. But it won't be overnight. Obviously, we're in a transition time. But I really feel that one of the disservices, and I'm looking more at what we're doing, is that this constant comment that they're in the 14th century, it's just wrong. It's wrong, it's elitist, and it's American-centric. Somehow we've got all the answers, which we, you know. And I think that part of it is lying with us. I can tell you that young women and women of all ages are performing at a higher rate. And this is going to be a weird thing to say, but women leaders are being assassinated, as you well know. I think it shows how seriously they're being taken by the opposition. You know, that women leaders of provincial women ministries, which is tragic that these women are being assassinated. There are not a lot of them, but they're certain. But that means they are seriously doing something. And I always say, when you're being targeted, there's a reason. And I do feel I'm very inspired at the courage and the competence of Afghan women, and every place they're real. It's so admirable what they're doing under very hard conditions, and we should stop putting people down and look at not only the realistic but the aspirations for and the hope. And so anyway, I don't know if that answers your question, but I do feel that we must have a serious part of the peace process when I say we Afghan women, and that it should be recognized how they are moving forward, and also recognize that there was a day when they were forward. Remember in Afghanistan, we were 40, women were 40% of the doctors before the Taliban era. I mean, and I can't get over the performance under very hard circumstances of Afghan women. It is really a sight to behold and to be admired. So I think that I'm hopeful for the future, but they need a lot of support, and I think they need a realistic analysis. And right now, I do feel that we are not pushing hard enough for them to be a part of the peace process. And I really think this business of negotiating with the Taliban has to be only under the one condition that women's rights will be treated seriously and that we're not going backwards and that the Constitution will be recognized as the bottom line, if there's any negotiations at all.
True. Before clear, I just want to add that in 1964, my great aunt became the first elected woman member of parliament, but elected from yes. Kabul. So that history goes back. It's not just recent. That's Claire, true. Would you like to add anything on this?
Yes, just a couple of things. One, I think we have to, I mean, your question implied that security will get worse. I think we should be operating on different scenarios. I think there is a scenario with successful elections and the country rallying together where security doesn't get worse, but certainly we should be prepared for different, or Afghans need to be prepared for different situations. Second, I think, as Elena said, continued commitment to security so that Afghans can defend the constitutional order that they've already agreed on. And that's the thing that's going to preserve the space for civil society, perhaps more than anything else that can be done from the outside. And then third, I agree that more is needed. We need to look again at how engagement works and perhaps move away from this model of, and not that you're advocating it, from big contractors that need these security contracts and things, and have much smarter ways of engagement, working through and with, in partnership with Afghan domestic civil society organizations, including businesses and professional associations, including, for example, the village councils, the now more than 30,000 village councils across the country, the NSP, women's groups, and universities. So more moving to this model of partnership, and including using technology that doesn't always require delegations to visit Afghanistan. They can now we can communicate without traveling.
Absolutely.
Yeah. David, let me ask you and repeat the question on BSA, but also about ANSF, since we worked closely at the Pentagon on this issue. How do you see the future of training and help and assistance?
Well, I think these questions are inseparably linked. The issue of security, the point that was made before about the concern that security will get worse as foreign forces pull down, and the issue of continued commitment and training for the Afghan security forces. And this goes back to the issue of political will and political direction here in the United States. Currently, there is no decision on what kind of commitment the United States will have after 2014. Certainly, a bilateral security agreement is necessary for that, but it does not define that commitment. I think the bilateral security agreement will go forward if the people of Afghanistan want it to. I appreciate very much the very correct distinction between jurisdiction and immunity, and the bilateral security agreement provides for jurisdiction, similar agreements that the United States has with other countries around the world, where when there are problems, criminal acts committed, U.S. servicemen are tried in U.S. military courts. They're not immune, they're just tried in a different system, and we've seen some of those cases recently where those trials have taken place and been carried out very professionally. However, while I'm optimistic, and I think the performance of the Afghan security forces is as positive as I mentioned it before, it continues to be fragile. And the point made before about anticipatory drawdowns based on lack of political direction, uncertain political direction, movements in the United States Congress to condition or cut the necessary military assistance, those kind of signals are are highly important in determining people's behavior. So you mentioned NGOs acting on the assumption security will be reduced. Well, if they act on that, then that can become a self-fulfilling prophecy. That's why it's so important for people in the United States to have accurate information, but for also for people to act, to pressure the elected officials in the White House, in our Congress, to go ahead, to preserve the investment we've made in Afghanistan, to preserve, particularly on the security side, because I believe that security is the foundation. I was one of my penultimate actions when I was in the executive branch, as I testified before a panel of the Congressional Armed Services Committee, and one of the members told me that it was very important that we guarantee the future of Afghan women, but she said, I support a complete withdrawal of U.S. forces. That can't be. A complete withdrawal of U.S. forces, abandonment of the United States, pulling out of the support for Afghan security will lead to disaster. You can't preserve the gains of Afghan women, of Afghan, of the rest of the, what the rest of the panel has put forward, without that continuing commitment. It doesn't have to be 50,000 troops and $10 billion, but it has to be enough troops and it has to be enough money to ensure that the Afghans themselves believe that it's serious. Otherwise, as Mr. Himayun was saying, people will move their money, they'll leave, they'll run to other countries, and disaster is possible. This is a determinative time, the next few months. Decisions will be made or not made, and it's really important that people advocate for continuing the kind of success that we've had that I believe will lead to both better security for the United States and an opportunity for the United States to fulfill its values in Afghanistan along the lines that we discussed before.
Thank you. We have time for one more round, and I think somebody, gentlemen here, please.
Ken Meyer, Gord World Docs.
We'll come back to you.
I've read that almost half of all Afghan diplomats don't go home upon completion of their assignment overseas. Is this a simple metric we observers could use to judge conditions in the country over time?
Okay, let's come back to the gentleman here, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike Kurtzig. What you've told us today is something that we don't know. I would say the American people are sick and tired of the war, of Iraq and so on. They're concerned with Obamacare, with their own employment, their own welfare. And what you've said to us, who even follow it, is a complete revelation. So how do you convince a nation that, first of all, doesn't know where Afghanistan is? Given the map, they have no idea where Afghanistan is. And number two, they have no idea that we're at war. Some of them have the idea, but I can tell you from my own teaching, many of them don't know. What do you need to do to convince them in a time with very difficult budgetary situations and interests of this country, to convince them that this is a worthwhile enterprise after 13 years and we should continue to be there?
Thank you. two more, just one here and one right there. Yes, thank you.
Farhad Pashbak with Booz Allen Khyber House. Just to pick on the comments that you made, there's a great deal of fatigue in the international community when it comes to Afghanistan, and a great deal of the discussion here is focused on security and politics. I would say that economics is an important pillar of transition. I wonder what your thoughts are on economic future of Afghanistan. The latest World Bank report says that Afghanistan's economic growth is going to slow down considerably in 2013 from about a 14% growth in 2012 to about 4 to 5% growth. And that's a fairly optimistic estimate. And depending on the amount of security spending and the delivery of international aid, there's a real danger that economics could become the biggest crisis in Afghanistan. I'm just wondering what some of your thoughts are, looking at the fatigue of the population here in the U.S. and Europe, as well as some of the concerns about the lack of private market growth in Afghanistan.
Thank you very much. Last one, and then we'll wrap it with answers, please.
You'll have a chance to discuss any questions you have with the panelists afterwards.
David? Claire. It's Craig Karp from carpology.com. I was just wondering, first on the agreement, I think that probably the best argument to the Afghans for getting this agreement through, and even for Americans, is what's happened in Iraq, since the agreement didn't go through there, as David will know well. My question is just a short one for Asib. You mentioned that people are asking now in Afghanistan, who does President Karzai support? Now, is that because they would support that candidate or because they would vote against that candidate?
Okay. Thank you so much. Let me take the first question about diplomats, since I may have a bit of interest in there. And I was quoted in the New York Times about that, saying that almost 60% are not going back home after their assignments end. I'm probably part of that statistic. But the diplomatic corps is very unique at the same time. It's an opportunity for some people who are uncertain about their future or who see better chances for themselves and their families under the conditions that exist. It's very unfortunate that the numbers are high. I run two embassies, and most of these numbers are very high in Western nations, and especially those who still accept refugees. Countries such as the Scandinavian countries, Canada, Australia, and others. There are restrictions in other places, but it's an indicator. It's a small indicator. There are a lot of other indicators as well. I mean, there are people leaving from all walks of life or wanting to leave from all walks of life. And what we need to do very quickly, and I hope that the political process and the political transition and the elections in particular and the BSA will have a huge impact if all of these elements are managed somewhat properly, relatively speaking, that the BSA is signed as soon as possible. You will see that it will not only will the price of homes start to increase again in Kabul, whether you rent or whether you want to buy, but the price of commodities will go down, and people are going to think twice about leaving and probably refrain from and decide not to leave. So the diplomatic corps is just one indicator. There are many others. For example, foreign investment. While you have the World Bank saying that the growth rate is going to be at such a level, there was another report today saying, again from the World Bank, saying that investment in Afghanistan over the last 12 months has increased. I mean, it's a bit mind-boggling, but it has. So there are those who still think that there's hope and that there's a future and there's a tomorrow and that investing today actually would be beneficial. And there are those who don't think so. But over the next 6 months, we are going to reach a point where it's going to be either or. And the BSA is going to be one element. The elections is going to be the other element. Okay, so going back to... let me start with Mr. Homayoun on the president and on Karzai and the support that he may give to one or another of his candidates.
I think that question again that I brought here is being asked as to who's President Karzai's candidate. Largely, you'll have to see it in the view of this general public sentiment about continuity, about making sure that we don't get any major break from what has been gradually built over the past 10 to 12 years in the country. So when people are asking the question of who's Karzai's candidate, there's some interest in trying to gauge who will represent continuity of that. But there's also a background to it. The background to it is that by far and large, he has emerged as the sort of, in many ways, the most prominent political actor in the country with access to a growing state machinery. A machinery that's largely at the service of his will, of his administration. So wherever he tells or how he plays in the elections, will have an impact on results, on people's on political actors' prominence or popularity, or even groundwork during campaign, or even support yielded to candidates who will go out there to campaign. So it's, again, it's a question. But one thing that we're waking up to in Afghanistan, I think we will increasingly, others will wake up to this around the world, is that this, the personality Karzai and the perception around them in the country, while it often used to go between extreme negative and extreme positive over the past 10 to 12 years, now that there's talk of legacy, there's talk of him phasing out and transferring power to others, people are starting to recount what has happened over the past 10 to 12 years and attaching a lot of positives to how he has managed things. In particular, when it comes to relations between different ethnic groups in the country, how he has created a balance amongst people without being too favoring anybody too much to the taste of the other, but also allowing space. One particular thing that he's increasingly being credited for is the open media and open sort of freedom of expression space that he has availed to the people over the past 10 to 12 years. We have a very burgeoning media scene, about over 60, 70 private TV stations now in the country, both local, provincial level, as well as national. And in all, if you were to screen, screen any of those channels on a daily basis, the talk shows, 60% of them will be, they will have talking heads being very harsh on the to the president. And we have no history of him trying to take any of those people on. The question now is being asked, that come elections afterwards, will we have the same level of patience and openness in the public space in the country or not? And that's crucial. So generally, again, the sentiment, legacy, nostalgia, all these things will build up, and then the role of state machinery in elections, those are being coupled together.
Let me go to you, Eleanor, by asking if, how do you view the impact of fatigue here in the West? To what extent is it impacting your work, for example, on the women and gender issue, before we go to the economy?
Well, there's no question there is fatigue. And I think a lot of it because there's such a negative impression that's been painted. So one of my answers to your question, how do you change this, is I do think that if a more realistic picture was painted, it would help a great deal. I do think that women's groups play a big role in this, women's groups in the United States and in Europe and around the world, as well as in Afghanistan, because we can rally support. And I think this is a very crucial a period. Do I think it's possible? Of course I do. I mean, in reality, we were able to do it with no positive press last time either. I mean, you know, people... I think there's much more knowledge today than there was back then of where Afghanistan is. I think that there's much more knowledge about the country. I mean, we were dealing with zero knowledge. But we do have to overcome the negative, and I think that there is a picture here that's truthful, that gives people encouragement. But I also think it can't be just the United States. I hope the European Parliament does more. The United Nations must do more. And Japan must do more. By the way, on economic growth, I just want to throw this in. The reason why I'm optimistic, why did we get there in the first place? I mean, we're not just innocent bystanders in all of this. We were a part of the problem. I think we even named this thing warlord. I don't even think that that's indigenous to Afghanistan. But why? Why were we so involved? And I think a lot of it is the oil pipeline. That's not going away. I mean, in other words, all of the mining possibilities, that's not going away. There's a business reality to this. And there's a geopolitical reality to it. So I just think that for us to think, oh, this was, there was a geopolitical reality that demanded us to do something. And that is not going away. I think that we have to make sure that the human rights component of it stays. And that, in fact, that we are helping to build a civil society and institutions that can weather all the storms. So anyway, I personally think this is going to be very tough. but it's very possible. And it would be terrible if we deserted this human responsibility now, not just here, but worldwide.
David, you want to add something before we go to Claire?
Just to make the point there, that in response to the how is it going to happen, it's only going to happen by people taking action. After 1945, there was a wave of isolation in the United States, but we still did the Marshall Plan. After 1953 and the Korean Armistice, there was a wave of isolation in the United States, but we still helped Korea along the path to the great country it's become today. The American people have a history of doing the right thing, regardless of whoever said it, sometimes after trying many other things. But it requires requires leadership that, to be frank, we're not getting from our current political leadership. And that's why the reason for the formation of this group, and if people here who have worked in Afghanistan, but people who haven't, I urge everyone who is here, who is listening to this, to become active yourselves. People can make a difference in the United States. We do have a system that can happen. And I find when I talk to members of Congress, they're waiting for their constituents to speak. They don't lead, they follow. And so it's up to people to lead.
Thanks. Claire, on the economy, and that would be the last topic.
Absolutely. And just on the danger of this disconnect between the reality and how Afghanistan is viewed, one thing that I observed is that the naysayers, the people who wanted to promote this negative view, were very organized. They were connected to each other and they were running a campaign. But the people who believe in Afghanistan and the next generation and have seen the possibilities weren't organized. They're beginning to be organized. The NASAP is part of that. But as David said, I think all of us welcome suggestions and ideas and participation. And just as in Afghanistan, there's a group of civil society activists coming together, here I think it's going to be a citizen coalition that will change it rather than being government-led. On the economy, right or wrong, or sadly, there will be a contraction from the aid economy, and this will have an impact. But coming off the level of aid that's been around for the last years is an inevitability. And I think the first point is, what measures can there be to mitigate this or to make it as soft a landing as possible? Whether it's jobs programs and social safety nets and so on will be important in the coming years and readjusting people's expectations. Second, imperative to preserve some of the key social programs, especially in health and in education. And then third, how do we shift away from a handout mentality to an investment mentality? So the support that does come and the policies for economic development, how can they be geared to this opportunity for Afghanistan to increase its domestic revenue, to make good on this incredible opportunity of the minerals, of its situation at the heart of Asian economic integration? I mean, maybe just a couple of examples. The blocks of gas that are now being tendered out in the north, if those go through and the level of interest that we're seeing from both Afghan domestic and international companies, this could bring Afghanistan $3 billion of revenue per year within a small number of years. So this will fundamentally change Afghanistan's ability to pay for its own healthcare and education system. But it's this critical next few years of holding the security and making these investments that will make that possible. Another example, if the transmission line gets built from the northern stans through to Pakistan, this will bring Pakistan power at 2 or 3 cents a kilowatt hour instead of the current 13 to 16 cents a kilowatt hour that they're bringing, and make Afghanistan part of the solution rather than part of the problem for Pakistan. So those are just two of the examples of the economic plans that are in place, that are underway, that again, if they're sustained, could see a real breakthrough in Afghanistan's ability to pay for itself.
Thank you so much. So we've covered quite a wide area of discussion and topics on Afghanistan. There's so much more, of course. I want to repeat one more time that this new organization, the Alliance in Support of the Afghan People, ASAP, is now active, and we wish it well, and hopefully more Americans will tune in and try to understand what it's doing and support it. And if I'm not mistaken, the website is afghanalliance.org. And I want to personally thank every one of our panelists, David Sidney, Eleanor Smeal, Claire Lockhart, and Asibo Moyun.
for sharing your time and your views with us. And we look forward to more discussions of this nature. They will be available for a few minutes as I run off to disguise my children. And they will answer your questions. Thank you so much for coming, Tanya. Thank you.